Okay, now that we got the zero mark, then very, very carefully, let's try and get this tape off of here. Try to get the mask off. And from here on, it's obviously just a case of taking your little plastic straight edge and X-Acto and cutting it out. Which I've already done on the other side. And believe it or not, that once you've got the markings on the airplane, this only took about, 20 minutes. And so, and the nice thing is, Friskit is so thin that, once you cut it out, it's ready for paint. There's nothing else to do. In the long run, I don't think that it's possible to beat Friskit for speed, accuracy of layout, and getting the job done. Okay, once again, some of the trickier things are probably worth covering more than once. Got my little knife blade in here. And we'll do a little cut, 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 cut. And a little cut, 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 cut. And just to show how easy this goes. Now the trick here is to find an edge. Find a corner with the edge of your and if you can lift the corner like this, and how much easier could it be? Fast, accurate, tightly masked, shouldn't be any paint running under there. Okay, we've got the markings, all of the major markings on the aircraft. There'll be any number of minor markings to be added later. But still, what we've got to do now is to mask off and spray white. I'm going to use aluminum foil for masking. It seems to be easier to use, faster, and certainly won't be penetrated by the paint. Okay, it's masked. And ready to paint. And as you can see, I'm not very good at masking. It's a nasty, nasty job, but I don't think there's anywhere where paint's going to get underneath. And so, nasty or not, we'll go pretty quick now. Okay, the white is on it. Now all I got to do is put 8 little red spots on and we're ready to take the masking off. The masking the little red bars at the edge of the stars is not the easiest thing in the world to do, but it's not the hardest either. The easiest way to do it is to put Friskit over the entire emblem and cut it out, because Friskit's an excellent mask. It protects what's down there with a good low-tack covering. Instead, if I tried to cover the stars up with anything else, and I got masking tape, and Friskit has less tack than masking tape. It's safer to use. And probably faster to install, since I can put on just one big piece at a time. Well, let's mask off a whole star at once. Then we'll cut out our little blocks. I don't know why that paper is so difficult. Maybe it's having been 30 years old, it's got something to do with it. Anyway, we'll just kind of plop this down here. And we'll kind of lift this a little bit. And it's masked. Now we'll come back in just a second here, and we will figure out how wide to make the red bars. Okay, I've been able to find correct government specified dimensions on stars and bars up to 1945. After 1945, when they added the red bar, I haven't been able to find anything really specific, which is to say trustworthy. And so I've resorted to measuring basically every photograph that I can find that has the star at more or less perpendicular to the camera, and as best as I can maintain, I don't know what the government's intent is, but I find these bars to be anything from 1/4 to 1/3 of the total width of the ear. With most of them falling in the area of being a little less than 1/3. 1/4 is definitely too thin. 1/3 seems to be acceptable, but a little less than 1/3 is probably a little more desirable. So, figuring millimeter wise, this thing is 37 millimeters across, and I'm making them 13, that's 26, and 11 here in the for the red bar, which is a little less than 1/3. Make sure we don't take off the bottom piece of Friskit. Okay, so anyway, on the side pieces there were 25, the bars were total width of 25, and so I did 9 and 9 is 18, and 7 is the width of the red that I used there. And now we'll put a few little red spots on the airplane. In the house, but don't tell Mia, for goodness sakes. Make sure your mask is down tight. And we'll let it sit for a few minutes and then put another color on it. And that's pretty much that until we until the time comes to take off the masking tape about an hour from now. Now, unmasking is usually fun, depending upon how many boo-boos you find. Okay, here's our big red mask coming off. The only place I really tried to stick it down was just at the red. Got to be really, really careful of the masking tape. It can pull your finish, and so easy does it. As much as possible, I try to stick masking tape on top of the Friskin and to itself. I really avoid sticking masking tape as much as possible to the paint. Now this takes a while. Friskin sometimes comes off in big pieces and sometimes it doesn't. Okay. Always going to be some little bitty boo-boos. And there's always going to be little bitty spots to touch up. Say that I haven't seen this before, but this is unusual. The paint didn't want to come off. There. I was trying to pull out from underneath the masking tape instead of being cut by the masking tape. But if you fool with it, that line will clean up. So, unmasking is more the same. Well, we can see that this is a good example of what kind of work that we can expect from Friskit. Lines are sharp and clean. Which isn't to say there's a tiny little spot here and there, but everything is repairable. Of course, this is clean enough that I won't even bother repairing it. Any tiny imperfections that still exist will just about die underneath the clear coat. Okay, now I've got the gears laid out in Friskit on the wing, and getting ready to mask. And by rubbing here in the wheel well area, I can actually outline the Friskit Okay, and that's about where that one is. Now let's see if we can find this one. I'm drawing about a quarter of an inch outside of it. Probably got to cut these things out and then come back and mask tape down to the brisket. And if you're careful, these things can be cut with an X-Acto knife. Like so. Okay, let's put some zinc chromate in the wheel wells. Zinc chromate is used on World War II aircraft as a very, very light chartreuse. Almost a yellow. I've gone over these already, making sure that all of the frisket edges are down just as tight as I can get them. And so we're ready to go on. Doing an epoxy paint job is a little more awkward than some of the other materials because you have to keep mixing the paint. Isn't easy. But you've got to mix the paint, get your color. And you've got to mix it with catalyst, and then you have to thin it. And takes forever to clean the guns, and so it's not as easy a material to use as the automotive paint that I used to do the wheel well on the Millennium. Okay, we're getting ready to add the wheel well details. In an attempt to make something of a three-dimensional appearing wheel well, which I tried for the first time on the Millennium, and it worked out for a first effort, the details worked out much, much better than I had any right to expect. So, we've got the wheel well all masked off, and let's talk a little bit about what the structure of the airplane looks like. That we'll have ribs and a real aircraft. And of course there are spars and a trailing edge spar. The ribs will support the structure at various stations going out the wing. But World War II airplanes were invariably built with lightweight skins, and therefore there's any number of stringers that run from the root to the tip for stiffening the structure. And so these represent stringers which run just underneath the top skin. Then, of course, the ribs are cut away in the wheel wells to provide clearance for the retraction of the gears. Still, looking from outside the wheel well into the wheel well, the edges of the ribs are still closer than the edges of the stringers, and the edges of the stringers are still closer than the top skin itself. And so there's a graduation in color there. So starting with the masked-off wheel well, the first thing we'll do is that we'll put some shadow there, because we're looking into a shadowed area. And so we'll shadow all the way around the edge. Okay, then the next thing we'll do is we would like the ribs being closest to the eye when looking closest to the light when looking into the wheel wells, they'll be the brightest in color. And so we'll mark off the ribs and we'll cover them with some strips of masking tape about 3/32 of an inch wide. And the paint that's under them and the shadowing around them is all they're going to get for now. Okay, now we've got, once the ribs are masked, then we put on the second layer of shadow. And once again, we shadow all the way around. Now we come back and we shadow some in the middle too, which is going to provide some definition for the ribs. So the ribs have one layer of shadow along the edges, and now we put a layer of shadow throughout the entire wheel well. Now we'll put down another layer of tape which represents stringers. Now the ribs only had the initial shadowing. Now there's two layers of shadow down, and now we put down the piece of tapes, and now we'll put down a third layer of shadow. Once again, we'll shadow the entire wheel well. And so, basically, underneath the ribs, we've got a little bit of shadow, and underneath the stringers, we have more shadow because they're further away. And finally, the darkest part of the entire wheel well will be the blocked areas which represent the top skin of the wing. It seems a little difficult to... And then finally we come back, of course, and we put the third layer of shadow. Third layer of shadow over everything. Anyway, so ultimately we wind up with a total of three layers of shadow in the bottom of the wheel well. Only two layers will be over top of the stringers, only one layer will be over top of the ribs. And so, like I said, it seems more complicated to explain than it does to do it. And you'll understand even better when you see it done. Okay, let's try a little bit of shadow. All around the edge, and quite a bit in the corners. Okay, that's about the right amount, I think. Okay, I laid out some lines. These are an inch and a half apart. And I put some masking tape down. It was about 3/32 of an inch wide. Now we pretty much put a coat of shadow over the whole thing, and there's got to be shadow along the edges of the ribs or it just isn't going to show up. So let's just start with putting some shadow along the ribs. Over the rest of the wheel well. Okay, to finish the job, I've laid out more strips at a 3/4 inch interval, and we will finally darken those. Now, it looks like I'm getting everything quite dark, and I am. The reason being, of course, it's a wheel well. It's very dark, and we don't want a lot of really bright chartreuse showing up on the belly of the stun ship. But we'll start by making little passes down the stringers. And then, once again, just a little bit overall. Okay, I think that'll give me a bright enough wheel well. Okay, let's see if we can get this masking tape off without pulling off everything. The ribs, of course, are a little brighter than the stringers, and that's exactly what we intended, because the masking tape went on before. Okay, now let's see if we can get the rest of it off. Well, to clean it up, we got a little piece of frisket there, a little piece of frisket there still to go. What the heck, let's get them. Aggravating. Here we go. And there we have it. Wheel well. Okay, ink lines on this airplane are virtually invisible because they're black on navy blue. Sea blue, actually, which is about the equivalent of insignia blue. Anyway, I've laid out my ink lines on a drawing, and I will transfer them to the airplane. In some cases, I'll be using a template. For example, I will make a template here for the vertical fin line. Now, everybody hates to make ink lines which go around the airplane because it's really, really tough to keep them all straight and aligned. In this particular example, though, I've taken a piece of this plastic template paper, or template stuff that scores we get from Tom. Good stuff. Whacked me off a piece long enough to go all the way around the nose, laid out my dimensions. I made this stuff about 5/8 of an inch wide, and then I put 5 layers of masking tape on it that wrapped around front and back. The idea being that there's enough masking tape here that the edge of the plastic is held up, not in contact with the surface at all, so that I'm not in risk of ink wicking underneath the plastic and making a mess. So, I made a line around here so far, a line around here so far, and now we've got to build some lines in this area. And like I said, it's unfortunate that you can't see better what I'm doing, but it's not an exercise in futility. I'm going to come back and I'm going to shadow these lines with gray epoxy at some point. And we will demonstrate the making of a template and putting onto the dorsal fin, even though it doesn't show very well on video. And the pen that I'm using is a Prismacolor. I got it from a local art supply house. It's black. It's PM98. It makes a nice line. It's about 0.7 millimeter wide. Generally, I draw with about 0.4 millimeter. 4 or 5/10 millimeter lines, but black on dark blue, having a little wider line than normal, isn't going to hurt anything at all. And it draws very well on the on a hobby epoxy finish. This piece of plastic with the tape wrapped around both sides. We're not talking about this stuff. I'm talking about the tape that's actually wrapped around both sides of the piece of plastic. Is going to make marvelous masking material. There are just places all over the airplane where it can be used. For example, it'll go around leading edges. It's going to go around the aft fuselage. I need one right now to go right around here, and I'm kind of torn between keeping this thing full length and just making me another shorter one so that I don't have to cut this one. This is such a handy length. And so, on the other hand, I think I'll cut it because it'll still do the largest lines that I anticipate on the wing. Okay, we're still inclining. And so it doesn't show much. Hopefully it's going to show more later. That I'm using inclines basically off of this tree view here. And right now I'm laying out the top of the wing here. Basically what I did was I scaled it, and the markings of the gun bay, well, from here to here, are roughly 340 millimeters, and that's the size of my airplane, and it's 49 millimeters here, and I scaled it off and so forth, and so I've drawn a template, and these of course are the wing hinge incline. Template for the wing hinge incline. So anyway, I've got to cut out this template and then draw this information on there, the gun bays themselves and the ammunition bays. Coming along, and we'll be able to tell a lot more. Kyle's due tonight. It'll be interesting to see if we can get some of the miscellaneous markings on the airplane. Okay, Kyle is here, and we're using some Frisket mask to dress up the airplane. And they're really fast to put on. Don't have to mask too far around them. Really going easy with the airbrush. And the results. Let's see if we can drop that just a little bit. Well, not quite readable. Nevertheless, the airplane is beginning to look very attractive. Just some of the markings. In this light we can see a little bit of the ink lines. When we start shadowing, they'll come up brighter. Okay, I'm still adding markings to the airplane. Actually, all of the ones I've put on so far have been specified by Grumman Engineering markings. But the airplane still looks a little bit naked here and there. And so I decided to add a few more that there were no specific markings for. And so these little pull-aparts from Kyle that I'm marking the ammunition bays. I'm not measuring them, I'm just sticking them down there. The airplane actually carried 826 rounds of 20 millimeter ammunition for its four guns. That doesn't divide equally in anything, so I just created a marking that says 20 millimeter cannon, 209 rounds, which totals 836 instead of 826. And I've begun to put some silver ink on the airplane wear marks, but I need to do a little bit more black first, and I haven't made my mind yet whether or not this silver will actually be finished before I put on 20mm, 209 rounds. I haven't made up my mind yet whether or not the silver will actually go on before or after the shadowing, the gray shadowing that's going to go on to indicate just normal accumulation of dirt, grime on the airplane. A working airplane, there's no harm in getting it dirty. And the more of that sort of thing that you do to a semi-scale airplane, the better it looks, if not entirely realistic. But it does give us something of an enhanced 3D appearance. So at this point, we're still sticking stuff on the airplane. Now I got a few more pushes to put on, some stuff we forgot before, and just beginning to put some silver wear marks from the belly around the gear door so far and the fuselage access hatch. But we will there'll be lots more of this, obviously. This and gray weathering. It's pretty much what we got left to do, plus some kind of fake fabric control surfaces. Now we just laid out some more ambles on the right wing and some pushes on the flap, and they're not equally spaced. These two are close together. This one's near the nose step. They are measured and they're equal from one side to the other. So you can get away with almost anything as long as you're apparently consistent with what you're doing. Let's do an ammo. Resist the temptation to do too much. These are great little frisket stencils, but I don't reuse them, even though I'm using the same wording. I'm using four identical stencils for this, for the ammo. It just doesn't pay to take a chance at a frisket stencil. They are very low tack. They just might not stick the second time as well as they stick the first. Not worth taking a chance. Kyle doesn't charge that much for them. Almost never a failure with these things. As a matter of fact, so far I haven't had any failures with them. They've been 100% successful, and boy, you sure can't say that about a lot of things that you work with. So they've been absolutely marvelous. Lovely. We'll use them on all my future airplanes. And the reason we're doing this one more shot of stencils is that It just shows that this need not be a terribly time-consuming operation. That doesn't quite touch. Possible could smear, but probably not. This stuff actually sets pretty quick. Here we go. Now the frisket may not stick too tightly, but the masking tape does, and that's good. Let's cut this frisket here so we can peel it off our masking tape. And we got one more push. I think they've actually shoved the airplane around the hangar deck, around the deck of the carrier with the flaps down, pushing on the trailing edge of the flaps. But they didn't want you stepping on the flaps. Well, okay. Anyway, the flaps were definitely factory marked push. And so we copied the factory markings. Any real rhyme or reason to doing factory markings on a stunt ship? The answer is no, but it gives me a bit of satisfaction, so what the heck. That's what it's all about. Okay, we mostly couldn't see the black lines going on the airplane. They were just too light to be much visible. I'm beginning to do some wear marks at the edge of the black lines. I'm using a Uniball. It's called a Gel Impact. And it says that it's a 1 millimeter wide line. But frankly, it's a lot skinnier line, or it can be a lot skinnier line. Actually, if you tilt the thing as you draw, it makes a fairly thin line. If you go vertically, then maybe it does make a rather thick line. Okay, but nevertheless, the technique for putting lines on the airplanes is all the same nevertheless. One, you don't want anything to slip while you're drawing. I already have black lines down there. Gotta have a straight edge. And these things draw real good. Got to be careful with these gels. From the standpoint, if you get hold of the wrong one, they don't draw very well. Or, more likely, they'll draw, but they're subject to rubbing off. I took a flap, an old flap, to the art supply house with me to find something that would draw without rubbing off. And the interesting thing is that this Uniball, there's another one that looks exactly like it. It has a slightly different marking on it, and it rubs off. They were in two separate bins. They're separately marked, and I don't understand the difference, nor am I particularly concerned with it. But the technique is the same for putting any kind of inking on your airplane. Tilting it like this makes a nice thin line. Holding the pen up makes quite a thick line. And believe it or not, I'm actually outlining black lines. Even though I'm sure it's a little difficult to see. Don't want to rush too much here and start smearing wet ink. This stuff does dry, thank goodness. The one that I used on the Millennium was this thing. It's a Staedtler gel roller. It says the point is 0.4 millimeter, which would make it much finer. This says it's 1/10. It's 1 millimeter, but this will actually draw a smaller line. The difference being that one doesn't dry, and so it's smeared until the day I put clear on the airplane. Now, some places it helps when you're doing these little broken wear lines to put one on both sides of the ink line. It kind of, like both surfaces are worn just a little bit, it dresses things up a little bit to have kind of a double line here and there. Like that. And I think I'll do another one here. As a matter of fact, there'll be some, you know, there'll be a few here and there all over the airplane. You don't want to do them all double. That's just too much. Drawing like this, not only with a straight edge, but with a tape to help hold while help me hold the pen, is a useful strategy also. And the other good characteristic of the pen is that alcohol takes it off. I just made a boo-boo. I will take it off with alcohol. Okay, I'm still adding markings to the airplane. Actually, all of the ones I've put on so far have been specified by Grumman Engineering markings. But the airplane still looks a little bit naked here and there. And so I decided to add a few more that there were no specific markings for. And so these little pull-aparts from Kyle that I'm marking the ammunition bays. I'm not measuring them, I'm just sticking them down there. The airplane actually carried 826 rounds of 20mm ammunition for its four guns. That doesn't divide equally in anything, so I just created a marking that says 20mm cannon, 209 rounds, which totals 836 instead of 826. And I began to put some silver ink on the airplane wear marks, but I need to do a little bit more black first, and I haven't made my mind yet whether or not this silver will actually be finished before I put on 20mm, 209 rounds. I haven't made up my mind yet whether or not the silver will actually go on before or after the shadowing. The gray shadowing that's going to go on to indicate just normal accumulation of dirt, grime on the airplane. A working airplane, there's no harm in getting it dirty. And the more of that sort of thing that you do to a semi-scale airplane, the better it looks, if not entirely realistic. But it does give us something of an enhanced 3D appearance. I'm about to put white on the side of the fuselage, exhaust stains. It's out of sequence because I haven't done the gray shadowing of the control surfaces yet, but the gray shadowing about all of the ink lines. Nevertheless, I've got white in the gun. I just put on the last of the stencils, and so I'm going to use up the white by going ahead and putting on the white exhaust stain on the fuselage, which represents ash. And so it really should go pretty much all the way to the tail. Not heavy, but it should be there. Subtle. Remember, we have three more colors to go on just for the exhaust. Brown will go on next. Finally, there will be a little black, which will make it look burned. Okay. I think that's enough on that side of the fuselage. Okay, with a little bit of luck, and if I don't get any sicker, tomorrow we'll make the dummy exhaust. We'll spray on the brown and the black, the brown representing... The white is, of course, ash. That's completely burned oil particles. The brown is partially burned oil particles. The black and the brown give the whole thing a little bit of a burned appearance, which really makes it attractive for a semi-scale sort of a situation. And then, of course, we've got to do the fabric control surfaces and outlines in the... to do the outlining and the shadowing in gray. Okay, let's give a shot at putting on some Zeus fasteners. These are not ordinarily difficult to put on, but for the moment I'm having problems with my ink. I drove all the way to downtown Dallas this morning. To get ink. Well, we're on a roll for the moment. It's hard to find ink for silver ink for Rapedia graphs. Matter of fact, it's hard to find Rapedia graph anything anymore because there are so many good pens out there that do the same job. But in this particular case, I need the point which can reach through the template. And so for this, not much of anything is going to work but a Rapedia graph. It isn't terribly important that these things be awfully, awfully accurate. We're only creating a look. Zeus fasteners were used during World War II for installing and removing cowlings. They're much faster than screws because they only turn a quarter of a turn. They're large. About a half dollar size. And again, like I say, they only turn a quarter of a turn. Once you've got your little circle on there, then you can put on your screwdriver slots. Freehand them on, parallel to the edge of the panel line. On the Millennium, I first drew these with black ink. And then freehanded over them with silver, making no attempt to complete each circle because I was only simulating features where the paint was scraped off anyway. Okay, tomorrow's a big day. They were going to get the shadowing on the airplane. And with a little bit of luck, we'll get the exhaust stains on the airplane. And if I have a really good day, I might even get the clear on the airplane, which will just about finish its appearance. To mask off the control surfaces on the elevators and the rudder, I started out with a piece of quarter-inch tape along the leading edge. There's a piece of eighth-inch tape along the trailing edge. The ribs are represented by about 3/32 tape. And of course, not where the hinges are located on the control line airplane, but and not even on the real airplane. There's still some representation of doubling up extra structure in area where hinges would be on a real airplane if these were, and they would show up on fiber-covered control surfaces, which is what this is all about. So, these are really not so much paint mask as stencils. And so I'm going to blow just very, very little paint against these. And I'm going to try to concentrate just in one area, like the leading edge and the tops of each one of these, like here. If you paint the whole things, then it doesn't look nearly as much like fabric and shadows. And so ever so gently, we'll just brush each of these places here, and then we'll put just a little bit on the trim tab. Same for the elevators, except that on the elevators and the flaps, I used 3/8 on the leading edge. These are quarter inch wide, and basically I started out with a 45 degree cut on it, stuck it on. When I got to here, I marked the 45, I lifted the tape, cut it with the scissors, and laid it back down again. This sure is a lot faster than building building these pieces the way I did on the Millennium. So, these are masks for shadowing of the control surfaces. And there really isn't any masking on the shadowing of the rest of the airplane, the various panel lines and so forth. I will, when I get to that point and start doing it tomorrow, I'll have probably something like a piece of manila folder stock with tape down one edge, and I will want to, for example, I will shadow this area here, and I'll do it by having a little piece of stuff like this, and I'll lay this down here. I'll just barely tack it in place, blow my stuff, peel it right up, move it somewhere else, lay it down, blow it, peel it up, move it somewhere else. It doesn't take a very long time to shadow an aircraft. So that's where we're getting to right now. We've got the white exhaust stains on the side of the fuselage, and that's out of sequence. We knew that was out of sequence, but I was using up the rest of the white. At the same time, I've got just a little bit of on the airplane, in the process of putting on the exhaust stains, I wound up with a little too much on the fillets. And that's going to be a problem too, but not a very big problem. So let's take a look at that fillet there. So, doesn't show too much, but I've got white right in the fillet, more than I want. From here back, it's okay. That would be realistic enough. But underneath the exhaust, no. I have 1 teaspoon of blue left. When I mix that with a teaspoon of hardener, I'll have 2 teaspoons or a tablespoon. And when I mix that with a clear, I'll have just enough to barely flow through my, to be picked up by my airbrush. And I will just touch this area just lightly as part of the paint process of blowing exhaust stains and so forth in the airplane. I'll put the brown on, I'll put the black on, then I'll touch up the blue, mainly here. The other side's the same, but not quite so bad. Which isn't to say that it's bad at all. And it's time now to start wiping the airplane free of fingerprints. I had some problems when I built the airplane. I had to do a lot of unexpected sanding. I've got some sanding scratches just on much of the airplane. But on the other hand, I'm also expecting that that when I put on the coat of clear, that it'll be enough to finally finish sanding. The blue sand filled most of the sanding scratches, and I think the clear will finish it to give me an overall smooth finish. I think my little air scoop worked out well. Looks good on the airplane. Looks realistic, even though we know that the real airplane didn't have an air scoop there. Right now we can see the brass screws, but in the process of doing an airplane like this, the airplane utilizes about 256. And so I've got a bunch of them here. And I'll paint them all blue. So I've got about 25 screws. Some longer because of the ones that go through the gear doors and hold gear doors to the landing gear are going to require longer. So we're looking pretty good. Looking forward to tomorrow. And tomorrow, with a little bit of luck, we could possibly get the last of the paint on the airplane. Then we'll give it a day or two to dry. Then we'll start assembling it. There's still work to do. The tank's got to be modified, and the remote ignition has got to be hooked up, and some soldering the tail wheel and the stooge hook has got to be soldered and so forth. So today is Tuesday. Wednesday, Thursday. We should get the airplane assembled on Friday. Take it to a show that we're having here, a forum. And then next week, I'll get the last of the details finished up, and it should be flyable next week. One other small area of concern, of course, is that the black ink lines are still virtually invisible. I think that with the clear on the airplane, they will be somewhat more visible, but still, they'll never compare to the silver. And so we've got white writing all over the airplane, all kinds of little stencils. We've got the silver, which shows up tremendously. And so the question in my mind was whether or not it was turning into a circus, whether the airplane was overdone. And I think that it is almost overdone, and I think it will be better than once we shadow it, then some of this will be cut in its intensity, and then particularly when we come back and blow exhaust things over the rest, that I think the result is going to be desirable. Okay, let's try to put a little gray on bottom of this flap here. And if you can see it, you probably did too much. Add a little on the trim pad. And as I say, there are spots where that's too much. Yeah, let's see here if we can just kind of do just a little bit of paper pushing. We'll just go and do the other side as well. really got too much there. Right there. But it should look kind of like frosting. Now let me peel the tape off and we'll take a look and see what we got. Notice it's epoxy, but the it's not that it dries instantly. It's just that if you're careful of just holding it by leaning and trailing edges, that you can pretty much go ahead and peel it off right away. Okay, and here's our really overdone spot out here at this tip. Ideally, it should just look like frosting. Very subtle. Trouble is, every now and then I forget how to work my airbrush. And the airbrush, you've got to push down all the way, full air, then pull back just a little bit for paint. And if you don't push down all the way for air before you start, it doesn't seem to want to atomize too well. And it spits paint instead of making a very subtle shadowing. Since I'm going to be shadowing today, then I've got to remember the lesson that I just learned and be more careful. And so it's starting to show. The fun thing about this is that even when you do it poorly, it looks good. So anyway, I'll finish untaping it and we'll stick it on the airplane and see how it looks. And okay, here's the aileron that we just did. It's unfortunate that my overdone part there, just the first rivet from the tip, would be on the top of the airplane instead of the bottom. But that's life. And we can also take a look at the tail surfaces, which are largely done, and see how the light frosting there seems to add depth and realism to the airplane. Okay, we'll do some shadowing on the wing. And the thing to notice about this is that it's just about freehanding. I've got a little piece of paper here with some tape on one side, which I've already used in many places, and so it's not very tightly held. But I'm using it as a stencil anyway. So it doesn't take much. The big problem, of course, is overdoing it. You just can't say the word subtle too often. Gonna have to get me another piece of masking tape here pretty soon. think you're not putting any on, but surprised when you take the masking tape off, you see that it's there. My masking tape has just about lost its tack. We'll get us another piece here in a sec. Remember, we're stenciling, so you don't really need a piece of masking tape to hold anything down. Not too much there. I'll do something about that later. Okay, and that's pretty much how it's done. Put some down the trailing edge. Good enough. Okay, so there's the bottom of one wing. Done with the, approximately the correct degree of subtlety. There's a little heavy spot here and there. I got a little spot at the intersection of this, and I was using, it may have been out of the picture, but I was using this and just holding it in place and spraying around it. We are, after all, stenciling, not masking. And what do you do when you boo-boo with paint? You know, alcohol takes off lines. Well, fresh paint, alcohol also takes off. And to some degree, you can even feather it. There we go. We can use two pieces of paper for this. Another little piece of anything, since we have a corner. Okay. There we go. Done and done. Got a heavy spot right there. I need to kind of blend up to it just a little bit. Good enough. And I really could use a little piece of template for that. Okay, now I'm preparing to do the exhaust stains. I mask off the area around the exhaust stacks, and before I thin my brown paint for spraying, we're going to do a little brushing work here. And the same on the other side. Now we'll thin the brown and blow it on. Okay, let's try a little fire for effect. Now we start putting it down the side of the fuselage. This time we don't go as far as we did with the white. Okay, I think that I actually skipped the blowing of the black. Nevertheless, the black is on there over top of the rust brown. And I got quite a bit of rust and so forth on the, there was already white on the fillet. Then I added, then the overspray rust was on the fillet. And so I've come back and I put some blue on there. And the blue looked kind of coarse, and I didn't know whether or not I got good coverage because it was reflecting so much light. So I blew a little bit of clear over just the fillet area, just in here, out to about there. Anyway, it looks fine, and I expect that I should get the control surfaces mounted tonight. I've decided to put the control surfaces on before I put the clear on. And it should be ready for clear in the morning. So we're getting there. Okay, we're ready to put the clear on. And so in 15 minutes, it'll be finished except for final assembly. Okay, let's finish this puppy. Thank you. it's finished now, except for a couple of minor details. I've got to revent the tank because I'm using a Venturi instead of a carburetor. But basically, that's about it. We should be able to get some flights on it this weekend. Weather permitting, right now it's pretty cold outside. It's 19 degrees. And we're going to see how things go. Anyway, this is the end of about 4 hours of videotape, which were devoted to the finishing of blue airplanes as opposed to the finishing of green airplanes. And so, it may or may not lead to another finishing tape. The reason, of course, that it might not is that the finishing tapes are there. They would be very much similar to the ones that already exist. And so, I'm not real sure that that this would have anything to add to the information that's already on the anything that's already on the Millennium tape. Nevertheless, it's a possibility that it could occur. The airplane turned out well. Right now it weighs 69 and a half ounces, and that's with the tank. That it could easily have weighed 67 and a half ounces, but because I had a terrible finishing problem in the as I was finishing the airplane, namely that I tried to use some computerized adhesive back stencils, and they pulled all the finish off of the off of all four wing panels and the left side of the fuselage, down to and including jet tissue. And so by the time I reworked the or repaired the airplane, I had picked up 54 grams, about 2 ounces. And so the airplane, I think, can easily be built at 67 and a half. And with a little bit more care than I put in, I think the airplane could probably even be built for 65 ounces, and that's with the Sato, with the 16 and a half ounce Sato. Anyway, I'm still pleased with the results. The Hobbypoxy or the Superpoxy Clear did not turn out with the same gloss that the polyurethanes did, but because the airplane is Superpoxy from the skin out, of course, from the sanding sealer out, then everything that I think everything is going to be a lot more fuel proof than the last couple of airplanes that I've built. I'm looking forward to this airplane lasting longer, being a more serviceable airplane. And so, when you put the airplane in some aspects, you can see, well, the wing is just, it's a big airplane, and the wing is just tremendous. And so, let's widen that out just a little bit. It is obviously a stunt ship when you look at it from this standpoint. So let's look at a few of the close-up aspects of the airplane and see what we can see. First of all, let's go in and take a look at some of the details on the bottom. And we have the gear doors. But additionally, there's a lot more detail in things like the fuselage access panel and various other wordings that are incorporated on the belly of the airplane. And of course, we do want to take a look at my little fake air inlet, which is there to cover the exhaust manifold and also to cool it. Okay. See if we can get a little bit of the cockpit here. The headrest, of course, is manila folder. The turnover structure is manila folder. The headrest, of course, is 16th.
The instrument panel is 16th, and that's crate paper above it, craft paper above it. And on the instrument panel, I used to cut out little instruments and go crazy trying to find little instruments of the right size, but those are just little circles of silver paint. And if you look at the airplane from any distance at all, it creates the same effect with a hell of a lot less problems finding something to put on. So anyway, the exhaust stains are colorful, intentionally so. The idea with the exhaust stains was to add a little bit of color to a very monochromatic airplane. Exhaust stains run basically to the tail. Some of the other interesting details perhaps might be that and the serial of the aircraft, well, that's the way we do it, and I just use my phone number. And while we're looking at details, let's see what we can see about the fake fabric surfaces. And let's widen that out a little bit so we can see all of the rudder. Little bit hard to see, but it's there. I guess one aileron is pretty much like another. Then there's a lot of shadowing and detail paint on the airplane. Lots of writing. Some of the writing is obscure, but it's all, it is mostly Grumman Engineering Standard. Here it says, for example, caution thread studs carefully. Well, the idea, of course, is that there are some threaded holes in the top of the wing, and one in the top of the fuselage, and these are used for hoisting the airplane to board carriers. So, back to the point of the airplane having turned out well, that if this tape is continued, it will result in probably a two-hour tape with finishing techniques. The finishing techniques will be similar to the Millennium, but not exact. This airplane had different problems and challenges in the paint job. And one more thing that I think is perhaps worth another look is the cooling air outlet. Which is to say, I think there's plenty. A little bit of the Zeus fasteners and inking and shadowing details.